You're listening to the audio production of The Fall of Lucifer, The Chronicles of Brothers, Time Before Time by Wendy Alec, published by Harper Inspire and read by Nathaniel Brady. Prologue. Petra 2017. The Lower Temenos, the Great Temple. The tall, frail figure, his entire weight leaning on the antique silver cane, limped slowly through the semi-darkness under the white hexagonal flagstones and past the triple colonnades until he stood directly over the entrance of the latest excavation site of the Lower Temenos in Petra, Jordan. Following him, at least 10 feet behind, was a young Arab boy.
"Hurry!"
The man's educated British tones were soft but compelling.
"Hurry!"
The command to the excavators became more intense. He watched the 5 Jordanian excavators with ill-concealed impatience, then beckoned to Wasim, who swiftly attached a harness to a rope around his waist. Discarding his cane, the Englishman started to ease himself down into the main shaft. Then he clenched his jaw to stem the sudden, intense tide of pain.
"Malik!"
Wasim cried. The Arab boy leaned forward over the shaft, clutching at the Englishman's linen jacket in horror. In that split second, the dim lights over the excavation pit flickered momentarily back on, suddenly illuminating the Englishman's face. Nick DeVere was young, extraordinarily young, not more than 26, and would have been handsome if his pretty, chiselled features had not been so frail. He sighed and brushed the blonde fringe back off his forehead, revealing serious grey eyes with long black lashes. He frowned intensely at the boy. "Wasim," he sighed, "are you my mother?" The boy scowled and loosed his grip on Nick's jacket.
"You are sick, Malik. You should not be doing this."
A weary smile flickered across Nick's mouth. He turned his back to the boy, suddenly shivering violently. Sweat poured from his temples. He felt in his pocket for his silver pillbox and with trembling fingers tried to open it.
"Wasim."
His voice was hardly audible. Wasim grabbed the pillbox from Nick's hand as the grey eyes started to roll back. Nick hung from the rope in the centre of the shaft, semi-conscious, like a dead weight. The Arab boy pulled on the rope, hauling Nick back into the cavern. He prized open the pillbox and thrust 4 of the gel capsules into the back of Nick's mouth.
"Swallow, Malik. Swallow."
Nick gulped and slumped to the dirt, his head in the Arab boy's lap. Wasim sang over him softly, like a mother. Much later, Nick edged his body down, down, 6 feet, then 12 feet down the scaffolded sides of the eastern shaft. Wasim followed, lowering himself down, 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 until they were both face to face with the second party of Jordanian excavators, deeper than any excavation party had ever dug before in the history of Petra. Nick's eyes fell on a small patch of golden metal glistening from beneath the ash. Zahid, his trusted chief excavator, an old Bedouin, stared up at him, his ancient eyes aflame with wonder.
"The 2 men of fire, Malik," Zahid uttered in his thick, broken English. "Maybe they tell truth."
Nick's breathing was shallow. Zahid motioned to the excavators to be silent. They fell back as one. He placed his ancient nut-brown hand over Nick's, pushing his hand down into the dirt on top of the golden metal.
"Maybe, Zahid," Nick murmured under his breath. "Maybe."
He started scrabbling through the dirt impatiently. Wasim joined him, their hands flying over the patch of gold.
"Whisk, Zahid," Nick said tersely.
Zahid thrust a soft bristle brush into his palm. Gently, Nick brushed the superficial dust away from the metal with small, expert strokes until the center was completely cleared, revealing a perfectly formed engraving the size of a dinner platter. Nick held out his hand.
"Wasim," he whispered.
Wasim handed him a scroll of yellowed paper. Nick snatched it from him and, trembling, laid it out across the metal next to the engraving.
The men of fire, Malik?
The ancient Bedouin's hands were shaking.
They tell truth?
Nick put on his eyeglass and leaned over the golden metal as Zahid and Wasim watched with bated breath. Slowly, Nick looked up, his face burning with ecstasy. Zahid, he kissed the old man on both cheeks fervently. Let them dig. Later. It was past 1 in the morning by the time the casket was fully visible, and another 2 hours before it rested under the walls of white hexagonal stone of the lower Temenos. It was 4 feet in width and 2 in depth, and of an almost translucent gold, embedded with a vast array of rare jewels. The casket strongly resembled the ancient Hebrews' sacred relic, the Ark of the Covenant, with its intricately carved golden cherubim and seraphim, except that it was smaller and had, etched in the very center, a large, beautifully engraved insignia, with 3 smaller engravings etched directly beneath it. Nick caressed the engravings.
The royal crest, Zahid, he whispered, of the house of Jehovah.
Wasim pointed to the 3 smaller engravings. He frowned up at Nick, his dark eyes wide with wonder. The seal of the 3 chief princes. Nick looked down at Zahid, who was rocking back and forth on the ground. The big men of fire, 3 archangels. Zahid's eyes grew wide with apprehension. Nick was studying the engravings intently. He traced the coat of arms gently with his forefinger.
Valor and justice, he murmured. The great Prince Mikhail.
Wasim pointed to the 3rd seal excitedly.
Jibril, Jibril, he shrilled.
Nick nodded.
Gabriel, he whispered. The Revelator.
Zahid stared, transfixed and trembling, at the 3rd engraving. Slightly larger than the other 2, it had 1 magnificent deep crimson ruby as its centerpiece. His rocking grew agitated. Nick gently ran his finger over the ruby.
And I expelled you, O guardian cherub, he whispered, from among the fiery stones.
Nick and Zahid exchanged a long, apprehensive look. Nick took a deep breath.
And now, for what we have come for.
With the aid of a mechanical jack, Zahid prized open the lid of the casket, wide enough to wedge 2 long wooden beams into the aperture. With 1 more turn of the jack, the casket's stone hasp fell in 2 pieces onto the ash floor. Nick looked back at the other excavators, huddled together and staring, petrified at the 3rd engraving. Like frightened animals, they scuttled off, leaving the 3 alone in the gloom. Nick nodded. The 3 leaned over and slowly raised the heavy lid. Immediately, the cavern was flooded with a blinding, iridescent light that rose up as 7 columns of blazing white flame, illuminating the entire chamber. Zahid and Wasim fell prostrate into the ash.
Allahu Akbar! Allahu Akbar!
They cried in unison. Nick stumbled to his knees, his arm covering his eyes from the searing heat. Gradually the columns settled, and as the white mist faded, 2 huge gold-bound codices became visible in the upper compartment of the casket. Very gently, Nick reached over and drew the top codex out.
The angelic writings, he murmured in wonder.
Slowly, he opened the codex, moving his finger along the lines of strange golden text. As he did, the angelic writings seemed to take on a life of their own, glowing, dancing in the shafts of light emanating from them.
The most ancient of ancient angelic writings, he whispered to Zahid, who still lay prostrate on the ground, his face to the floor.
Slowly, the old Bedouin lifted his head to the codices, staring in wonder at the pulsing angelic script now in Arabic. Nick traced his finger along the title, the glowing Arabic lettering instantly transforming to English. The Secret Annals of the First Heaven. The Fall of Lucifer. His voice fell to a whisper. As recorded by Gabriel the Revelator. Aftermath. 2028. Lucifer stood, an imperial figure, his monstrous black war chariot riding on the shafts of thunderbolts. The huge silver wheels sprung with the sharpest war blades, was pulled by 8 of his finest dark-winged stallions, their manes intertwined with platinum, caparisoned as for war, glistening black as the night. And then, for a fleeting moment, the sun's rays broke through, the clouds dissipated, and Gabriel could see Lucifer's lips moving incoherently with the incantations of the damned. Gabriel did not turn to him, but saw his stallion's shadows on the clouds as the war chariot thundered past, the crimson emblem of the infernal flame on hell's flag flying proudly. He passed so close that Gabriel's white mare trembled and snorted at the putrid reek of his satanic wizardry. Gabriel turned his head from the damning presence. The scarred, misshapen features were now masked behind the battle helmet, the soulless sapphire eyes imperious, his bearing still kingly. He held his head high, his long raven hair gleaming and plaited with platinum and lightnings, his fist brandishing the cat-o'-nine-tails menacingly. Lucifer was all glorious and all terrible, as slowly he surveyed the valley before him. A thick red mist of human blood mingled with the reek of burning human flesh that rose unendingly from the Valley of Slaughter. Millions of massacred soldiers, Chinese, European, American, Arab, Israeli, floated next to drowned horses and half-submerged tanks and other armored vehicles in a vast quagmire of blood and mud 1,600 furlongs long. All that was left after the assault of the massive 200-million-man army. Hundreds of thousands of griffin vultures, their wingspans over 9 feet long, blackened the crimson skies, circling the killing fields, while massive swarms of raptors gorged ravenously on human flesh. On the outskirts of the Valley of Jezreel, on higher ground, bodies, severed limbs, and decapitated heads lay in random piles. A holocaust. The eerie silence hung heavily over the valley. Nothing stirred but the blood-curdling screeching of the vultures. Lucifer waded through the bloody quagmire, which reached up to his dark stallion's bridles, towards higher ground. A smile of approval crossed his crimson mouth. Then, sensing a presence, he turned the war chariot around. Several lengths away, at the edge of the gorge directly opposite Lucifer, a regal figure mounted on a splendid white Arab stallion surveyed the valley. Michael took off his golden helmet, his long corn-coloured hair falling to his broad shoulders. His green eyes gleamed with nobility. He raised the sword of justice, his jaw clenched, the only sign of his blazing fury. A wry smile played on Lucifer's features. He turned and mockingly saluted. "Put your sword away, brother." Lucifer's voice shattered the eerie silence. "It is not yet time." "The judgment hastens, Lucifer." Michael's noble tones rang out across the valley. Lucifer lifted his visor with one sharp movement. He pulled on his stallion's reins, his impatience thinly veiled. "Even Michael cannot preempt what is written." Across the valley, Michael waited, fierce, silent. Bareback on his white steed, Gabriel came into view behind Michael on the horizon, his long platinum locks falling past his shoulders. his face and...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.